Hi, I'm Susan Taylor with Scripps Health in San Diego, California. Today we're going to talk about testicular cancer. According to the American Cancer Society, one out of every 250 men will develop testicular cancer at some point in their lifetime. And this is a young person's disease. The average age at the time of diagnosis is just 33. Here to talk about testicular cancer is Dr. Ramdev Konijeti. He is a urologic oncologist with Scripps Clinic in La Jolla, California. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
Testicular cancer, what is it?
Well, testicular cancer, like any other type of cancer, is cancer that arises from the testicle, can spread to other parts of your body and threaten your life if left untreated.
And what causes it?
We don't entirely know what risk factors there might be other than some very basic things. Children who are born with undescended testicles are actually at higher risk of developing testicular cancer later in life, so they should be monitored a little more closely. Folks who have a family history can be at risk. Beyond that, we don't have a lot of good risk factors that we know of that we can target for testicular cancer.
So what are the symptoms of it?
Often people will come to us with a mass growing on their testicle. They feel a lump or a bump, and they come to our office to evaluate it further, or they'll come to a doctor's office in general, which will then prompt additional imaging with something like an ultrasound, and that can often identify or differentiate what is suspicious for cancer versus not.
And is it painful?
Usually not. It's usually painless, but people will often notice a rapid growth on their testicle over the course of a matter of weeks.
And then also in men, their breasts apparently can grow or become sore, and this is a symptom of testicular cancer?
Well, it's very uncommon for that to be the case. There are certain types of testicular cancer that can secrete hormones that can cause that to occur, but it's definitely not a very common type of symptom that a person can experience.
And in some cases of testicular cancer, there are actually no symptoms?
That's exactly right. In fact, in most cases, there are not symptoms.
Which is very unsettling.
It is.
So you referenced this. In advanced cases of testicular cancer, as you said, it can spread to other parts of the body. Where?
Testicular cancer can primarily spread to the lymph nodes, but it can spread to the lungs and or the liver. Those are very common locations if left untreated.
And what are the symptoms if it has spread to other parts of the body?
Well, like any other cancer that spreads to other parts of the body, people can develop symptoms of unintentional weight loss. They can develop abnormal liver function tests, which are blood tests that we commonly do to check up on the liver. They can develop respiratory problems if they have spread to the lung. But as I said, more often than not, most people don't have a lot of symptoms of spread other than noticing a lump on their testicle.
But there are some symptoms, though, if it's spread, such as low back pain. Is that correct?
Low back pain can certainly occur if they're spread to the bones or if a person gets an enlarged lymph node to the point where it's creating or pushing up against other structures in the body that can make them feel discomfort.
Shortness of breath?
Shortness of breath it can happen certainly if it spreads to the lungs and or, again, if it's pushing up against their diaphragm.
And chest pain and belly pain?
Belly pain can occur. Chest pain is less common. Belly pain can simply occur if anything is growing inside the abdomen and it pushes up against things. You can have loss of appetite, feelings of early satiety where you're getting full really quickly and you're not eating large amounts of food.
And headaches and confusion?
Headaches and confusion can occur if it spreads to the brain. Certainly that can occur, but short of that, it's unlikely.
So how do you know it's time to go see the doctor to get these things checked out? Because with back pain and chest pain and belly pain, we don't usually associate that with testicular cancer.
I think it's safe to say, for the most part, with rare exceptions, if there's no lumps on your testicle, it's unlikely that you have testicular cancer if you're experiencing any of those other symptoms. I think the main thing a person can do very easily, especially in men, it's easy to just do a self-examination to make sure you don't have any new growths on your testicle that you didn't otherwise detect or before.
Okay, so we want you to hold this thought. You just referenced this. We're going to come back and talk about this. The American Cancer Society recommends that women do a monthly self-exam of their breast to help detect breast cancer. Does that same thing apply to men with regard to testicular cancer? Hold that thought. We'll come back and talk about that. Who is at risk for getting testicular cancer? You talked about an undescended testicle at birth. What else?
Really, that's the most common one. I think there continue to be studies to look at exactly which individuals might be at higher risk or which populations. We haven't gotten a ton of information in that regard. I think the main thing is if a person has a history of an undescended testicle, even if that's been surgically corrected, that person remains at risk of developing tumors or growths on their testicle, and they should continue to do self-examinations. But in general, everyone in the population, especially people between the ages of probably 16 to 25, as well as people between the ages of 30 to 40s, we have a bimodal distribution of the risk of testicular cancer. It happens, it peaks in those two age categories. When people are sort of in their early 40s as well as they're in their early 20s, you see a spike in the diagnoses of testicular cancer.
But there were also some studies which said that certain ethnic groups, white men, for example, 4 to 5 times higher risk than African American and Asian men.
That's true. When you're looking at all individuals with testicular cancer, there's no doubt that white men are at higher risk than other ethnic groups as far as we can tell based on the data we have. But even within the population of white men, it remains a relatively uncommon type of cancer.
And also an increased risk for folks who have HIV infection and AIDS?
You can get tumors that grow on your testicle because of the immune suppression that's associated with HIV infection and AIDS, but that's usually related to lymphomas or other things that happen to pop up on the testicle, but they're not primary testicular cancers, meaning they're not only in the testicle, they may be in other parts of the body.
You talked about this a minute ago, but this really is a young person's disease. When you think of cancer, you think of, you know, somebody who's in their, what, 50s, 60s. Why so much younger for testicular cancer?
Well, the testes are more active in people when they're younger. They're producing more testosterone, they're producing sperm, and things like testosterone and sperm production are associated with our youth. We don't have children necessarily when we're much older. And so when the testicles are more active, that, like any other organ in the body, that's when something might go wrong.
How do you test for testicular cancer?
We start with an ultrasound. If a patient comes to us with an abnormal growth on their testicle, one that they didn't identify before, we'll order an ultrasound to evaluate it further. And if that indicates that there might be a tumor that's concerning for cancer, we then do some blood tests to look for something called tumor markers. We also will do potentially a CT scan or some type of imaging to look at their abdomen to make sure there are no enlarged lymph nodes. We would also do some imaging of their chest, either a CT or an X-ray of their chest, to take a look and make sure their lungs look okay.
And then how do you treat testicular cancer?
Well, we start by removing the testicle. We make an incision in the groin and we take the testicle out that way. We don't take it out from the scrotum. And that has to do with the anatomic way that the testicle drains its blood. And once we get a diagnosis from our colleagues in pathology, that can help us decide what further treatment is necessary, if any.
And what's the recovery time?
After a removal of a testicle, people feel back to their normal selves usually within about a week. We tell them to avoid heavy lifting or straining for up to 6 weeks, sometimes much sooner depending on how much of an extensive procedure we had to do to remove their testicle.
But with the latest technology, the surgery is much less invasive, right? Because you've got this, talk about the laparoscopic surgery.
Well, I think we're talking about surgeries that we would do for testicular cancer that might have spread. So in that case, we do abdominal surgery to actually clean out the lymph nodes in the abdomen. And in that case, there are some options to do that with laparoscopy, where we put cameras inside the body and use instruments to do that to avoid having to make a bigger incision. Or we even use a robot to do that, where we connect those instruments to a robot and the surgeon controls the robot from the corner of the room. But typically, to just remove the testicle, it's an outpatient procedure, and people don't have to stay in the hospital. It's just a little incision in the groin. We get it out, and hopefully in the majority of cases, actually, people don't need additional surgery beyond that.
So having a testicle removed, does this affect a man's ability to have sex and also father a child?
It's a good question. We talk to people about banking their sperm ahead of time if we do talk to them about removal of a testicle, because as you mentioned, folks who do have the diagnosis of testicular cancer are often younger, and they're often not yet in relationships where they're even thinking about children, or maybe they're just newly married. And so we talk to them about banking their sperm in the event that they want to have kids in the future, so that enables them to do that. And it's not so much because removal of a testicle makes you infertile. You should be able to father children with a perfectly good testicle on the other side, but the issue is if you have to go through additional treatment, say in the form of chemotherapy, that can be toxic to your sperm as well, and so even the remaining testicle may not have viable sperm that can be used to father children. In terms of the testosterone issue, same thing. Usually, if people have a good testicle on the other side, there should be no effect on their overall testosterone levels.
So talk about the other treatments, though, after surgery. Radiation, chemotherapy, immunotherapy. How often does that come into play?
Chemotherapy is probably the mainstay of treatment for individuals with testicular cancer where we're either worried about spread or it has spread. Radiation therapy can be used for certain subtypes of testicular cancer, but chemotherapy is probably the most common form of what we call systemic treatment, or treatment that gets into your whole body.
And what about survival rates?
Survival rates are quite good. In fact, the earlier we can detect it, the better the survival, but when you take all comers with testicular cancer, you're probably looking at over 80-85%+ of individuals have a cure rate.
So we referenced this a couple of minutes ago. Let's come back and talk about this. The American Cancer Society urges women to do a monthly self-exam of their breasts in an attempt to detect breast cancer early. Is the same recommendation for men to do a monthly self-exam of the testicle?
It's certainly easy to do a periodic self-examination. I don't think we've come up with any specific guidelines on how often it should be done, but particularly in the shower when things are a little more relaxed and it's easier to feel your testicles because of the steam and the heat, is probably the most convenient time for a man to examine himself. And we just say periodic self-examinations are useful. Testicular cancer will often grow over the matter of weeks, so you'll notice or a man will notice if there is something growing there when he's in the shower, if he's checking himself on a reasonably regular basis. I think monthly is perfectly fine.
Any final thoughts, doctor?
I think people should just take care of themselves as they continue to, and it's an easy thing to identify if you do regularly check yourself, and it's a very curable disease, so there's a lot of optimism to be had, even if you're someone who suffers from this.
Doctor, thanks so much for being with us. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
If you'd like more information on testicular cancer, please click on the link or go to scripps.org/videos. Want more critical information about your health? Please subscribe to our Scripps Health YouTube channel and follow us on social media at Scripps Health. I'm Susan Taylor. Thanks so much for joining us. It's our mission at Scripps to help you heal, enhance, even save your life.